We want to go to our CBS News national security analyst and former deputy national security advisor, Juan Zarate. He's joining us now in Washington, D.C. Juan, thanks for joining us. We really appreciate it. What do you make? I think that the news that a lot of people, especially in this country, are going to be focusing on is beyond the problems that Europe has in integrating people of Algerian or North African descent, Moroccan descent, but how this person, the last remaining suspect on the run from the Paris attacks, could be living in the neighborhood where he was born, presumably known by a lot of people, and the police, as Elaine pointed out, perhaps, we don't know, we're expecting a press conference from the Belgian prosecutor to happen very, very soon, but that this may have just been a lucky shot.
Well, Vlad, you raise a fundamental question and concern for European authorities, which is the radicalization not only in their midst, but the reality that the Islamic State has taken advantage of that environment and been able to put militants and fighters back into place in order to not only execute this attack in Paris, but potentially execute other attacks. And I think that what you're asking about is really a fundamental question of counterterrorism and law enforcement in Europe moving forward, which is, do we understand the radicalization in our midst, those that are drawn to the allure of this ideology and are willing to mobilize on behalf of the Islamic State, Al-Qaeda, or some other offshoot of this ideology? And secondly, do they have the means to be able to ferret out and to identify these networks, both before and after the fact? And this then raises questions of surveillance, encryption, and whether or not even the best of services in Europe, like the French, like the British, are able to actually understand the threats in their midst. And so this is an important episode in that they've captured a fugitive, but as your question indicates, it does raise some fundamental questions as to whether or not the Belgians, the French, and the Europeans can handle the threat that's in their midst and may be evolving very quickly.
Juan, I'm curious about what we know regarding cooperation and communication by Belgian authorities in particular. I raise this because we were speaking a short time ago to a reporter for EU Politico who said that based on their reporting for a story that they're putting together, for instance, the Italian authorities said that Belgian police had only communicated, or the Belgian terrorism authorities had only communicated with them once in the months since the Paris attacks back in November, something that struck her anyway as perhaps unusual, because given obviously the fact that the suspects were there, given the concerns out of Belgium, it seemed as though there might be more improved cooperation. But she had said from her reporting, there didn't appear to be. What do we know about Belgian authorities?
Well, we know that cooperation has been better both out of Belgium and within Europe, but the system is flawed. And I think Belgium in many ways suffers from many of those flaws. First of all, I think they're in some ways overwhelmed by what they're now experiencing, how to deal with the threats coming out of neighborhoods like Molenbeek, how to deal with potential militants. We saw on Tuesday what happens when the police go in to make some arrests or to execute some warrants and some searches. They're engaged in a firefight and actually have to kill a suspect. And so in some ways, there's a bit of an overwhelming factor of having to confront these threats now in a very real way. And so that's part of the problem. Secondly, there has been increased cooperation, but that's often happening in a bilateral way or with particular services. And so there isn't sort of a very broad information sharing environment that, for example, the United States created post 9/11. There is information sharing, and it has gotten better, but it tends to be point-to-point and in a very binary way. And finally, Europe-wide, there is yet still to be an information sharing protocol and set of rules of the road, especially with concerns over privacy and civil liberties, that allows the freedom of information sharing between the Belgians and the Italians, or the Italians and the French, et cetera. So though they talk about a Europe-wide security structure, the laws, the processes, the culture really hasn't allowed for real-time information sharing of the type that many authorities think is not only necessary, but is warranted given the threat.
Juan, just one moment ago, maybe about 15 minutes ago, Anne Hidalgo, who is the mayor of Paris, put out on Twitter, and it's in French, but I'm reading it to our audience now, congratulations to the forces of order that have arrested Saleh Abdeslam during an operation that is still ongoing in Brussels. That is a tweet from the mayor of Paris. We're expecting French President François Hollande and the prime minister of Belgium, Charles Michel, to address the world about this capture. Here's a question for you, Juan, in your capacity as a terrorism expert under former President George W. Bush. What do we know? There's been a big discussion in this country about interrogation methods. What do we expect the French or the Belgian authorities to, I guess, for lack of a better word, how do we expect them to interrogate him? Are we expecting that ISIS gives a lot of information to people that they ask to carry out these kinds of attacks? Or is there just a need-to-know basis, and they're not going to get a whole lot out of him, and he's not going to provide any more intelligence than they probably already have?
Great set of questions, Vlad. And by the way, CBS is lucky to have you, you having lived in France and being able to translate on air. So that's a great job. But in terms of information, obviously authorities are going to want to know about anything tied, obviously, to the Paris attacks, but then moving forward. And the fact that he's been on the run for some time, they'll want to know about his support network, if there are any other operatives at play. Again, they're going to be worried that the raid on Tuesday relates to other cells and activity. And so first and foremost, authorities in Belgium and France are going to want to know about what he knows about the existing networks in Europe and in the environment. Then they're going to want to know what is happening out of ISIS. Because again, remember that the Paris attack was really the manifestation of the worst nightmare for European authorities, which was the ability of ISIS to implant some of their foreign fighters back into Europe and then execute a fairly strategic attack. They will want to know, authorities will want to know, is there more of that being planned? Are there others like him and other cells that may be implanted in ways that they may not know about yet? So those are the types of questions they'll want to know. Whether or not he has that sort of in-depth information, whether or not ISIS has cabined some of that, I think we'll soon tell. Be able to tell that. But for the most part, I think ISIS has been fairly disciplined about how it's doing its work and, frankly, fairly open about what it's intending. They intend to put fighters back in place to attack. They intend to inspire those who are radicalized to attack in place. And so in some ways, ISIS may be cabining information. On the other hand, ISIS is being fairly open about what it's intending to do. Now, your question about what they actually do with the individuals, they're obviously not going to put them onto an island or in a particular interrogation program. But it is important to note that in continental Europe, the prosecutorial magistrate and Napoleonic system allows these authorities to question individuals for a long time, to hold individuals actually for long periods of time as part of an investigation, and to try to gather as much evidence and information as possible. And so you're going to see authorities taking their time and trying to understand as much as possible with this individual before having to dump him into the legal process and ultimately putting him in jail. And so this will be an interesting legal process to watch in addition to watching the threat mitigation unfold.
Juan, I don't want to put you on the spot, but I am curious about just your assessment, because we are going to be seeing here the French president, the Belgian prime minister, talk about this in much the same way that we saw in that tweet that Vlad just read as a success on the part of counterterrorism officials. But from what I understand now, there was a raid on Tuesday there was an operation that took place on Tuesday in which it was almost sort of accidentally discovered that the fingerprints, the DNA of Abdeslam ended up being in this house, which authorities thought was empty. Authorities didn't realize that there was anyone there. They made that connection, and then that kind of got us to where we are today. Now, obviously, given the fact there's still a lot of unanswered questions right now, but we know for a fact there had been various rumors and reports that Abdusalam had fled back to Syria. I know there had been some media reports of possible sightings there, but it has been 4 months now. Would you characterize this as a success on the part of counterterrorism officials?
Well, the fact that they captured him is good news, and no doubt you're going to have public officials trying to make the best of it, obviously, and they want to reassure their publics that they've got the situation in order and are understanding who is involved not just in the Paris attacks, but they're dealing with future threats. And so that's why you're going to have a very positive spin from policymakers. But Elaine, you're right. This raises some fundamental questions. This is right under the noses of the authorities that you have this central fugitive and figure still living and operating. And it appears that the authorities have been less methodical or at least less able to ferret out where these individuals are and how these networks are evolving. And I think that's the biggest challenge here for authorities, because it's the question of the unknown. What don't we know about what radicalized individuals are doing in these particular neighborhoods that are hotbeds, like Molenbeek? What don't we know about how ISIS is deploying trained fighters? We know that there are thousands of Westerners who've traveled to Iraq and Syria, many of whom have traveled back. What don't we know about, for example, embeds in the refugee populations, which has been a major source of concern both in Europe and the United States? And so this raises many questions, fundamental questions, in addition to being a moment of some celebration for counterterrorism officials, and at a minimum, capturing a dangerous individual who was part of the November 13th attacks in Paris.
Juan, we know from earlier that President Obama was briefed on this operation. Can we expect that security officials in the United States are also going to be very interested in what Saleh Abdeslam has to tell French and Belgian authorities, and perhaps we might glean some information that might perhaps help us?
Absolutely, Vlad. And I think there are a couple of angles to this. First is understanding better what the threat in Europe looks like. The threat in Europe is important to the United States, not just because of the threat it poses to our allies or even to U.S. citizens or interests abroad, but you have the challenge of Europeans traveling to the United States, perhaps without greater scrutiny, and the challenge of exposure to the United States based on Westerners having been trained or implanted in Europe. And so that's one area of interest and concern. A second will be whether or not there are Americans in the mix. We saw just recently the footage of the American out of Virginia turning himself into Kurdish authorities in Iraq after having traveled to Mosul to be a part of ISIL. So U.S. authorities are going to be very interested to know about what the American population of foreign fighters looks like. And so to the extent that that's something that comes out of these interrogations, that will be of interest. And finally, U.S. authorities will be very interested to understand how ISIS is thinking about its strategy abroad. How is it thinking about attacking the West? Who is it thinking about using? How aggressive are they on their timetable? Those are all things that U.S. authorities will want to know in order to calculate how serious the risks are and how to evaluate the threats that they're seeing on a daily basis.